It's a Midwestern Marx podcast. It's a Midwestern Marx podcast.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Midwestern Marx podcast. My name is Eddie Smith, alongside my co-editor Carlos Garrido and the Midwestern Marx editorial board, to bring you a very special episode of the podcast. Today, as a collective, we will be interviewing Peruvian Marxist academic and Midwestern Marx writer Sebastian León. Yesterday, Pedro Castillo, a working class Marxist, won the presidential election in Peru. And given these developments, we wanted to create a resource where socialists and communists from around the world could learn about the political and economic history of Peru, their struggle for socialism and against imperialism. As Marxists, we want to contribute to an analysis of Peru that uses historical materialism to understand the developments in Peru, which has led them to this current point. So with that being said, I'll kick it over to Carlos to introduce our interviewers, as well as our guest of honor here, Sebastian.
Thank you, Eddie. As you said, today we are joined with a few comrades from the Midwestern Marx editorial board. Participating, we have comrade Mitchell K. Jones.
Hello.
Calla Winchell.
Hello.
And Tim Russo.
Solidarity, everybody.
As for our guest today, Sebastian is a philosophy professor at the Pontifical Catholic University in Lima, Peru. He is a longtime militant and a writer for Midwestern Marx and the Marx and Engels Institute in Peru. Sebastian, we are honored to have you on. How are you doing today?
Very good, thank you. Thank you very much for the invitation. I'm really honored to be here.
Well, before we start into what was our regular scheduled questions, I wanted to bring up something that's somewhat of a new development, what's going on with the election, and I heard it's going to the courts. So do you mind speaking about that real quick before we start?
Yeah, sure. As you know, we won for a very tight margin. And Keiko Fujimori's team had a collaboration with some of the most prestigious law firms in Lima. And they tried to annul around 200,000 votes from the south of the country, the Andean south, with some, I don't know, arguments like she said that there was some problems with the signatures, and that the fact that many people in some of these towns in the south have shared the same last name, and trying to look for excuses to annul these votes. Among other reasons, because many tables didn't even have a single vote for Keiko in the south. So they argued that was a probable fraud. But, it's like making up excuses for that. They didn't have any evidence to really affirm that was the case. So in the end, they tried to present these arguments to the National Jury of Elections, but they forgot to pay a fee that they had to pay. So there were 800 tables, and in the end there was 150 that they did pay. So the jury tried yesterday to extend the time for them so they could pay for everything and present all the tables they wanted to annul, but there was a massive demonstration last night and they backed down. So that's it for now.
When you say tables, you mean tables full of ballots?
Yeah.
All right, very well. We just wanted to start with that because that's the most recent development we had. And so without further ado, let's start with our scheduled questions. So Eddie, take it away.
All righty. Yep. I'm going to ask the first question here. So as I was looking into the history of Peru, I noticed that one of the lesser known revolutions in Latin American history happened in Peru in 1968 when Juan Velasco Alvarado and the Revolutionary Armed Forces took power in Lima. And some people reject that this was even a revolution, given its top-down military character. But the reforms that Alvarado put into action were very real. He nationalized a major U.S. multinational oil company, nationalized transportation, telecommunications, and passed a massive agrarian reform bill. This was before he was overthrown by more conservative factions in 1975. But can you talk about the impact of Alvarado's revolution, whether it was a revolution at all, and did it set the stage in any way for the civil war, which would follow between the Shining Path and the military?
Okay, that's a really good question. So let's see. It was back in the day when this happened in 68, that it was a shock for the left, because, you know, it's shocking, you know, like a coup d'etat from the military, and they were left wing. And they tried to implement the reforms that the left had been trying to do for decades. So yeah, it was shocking, and the left tried to understand what was happening. And there was like a division among the left, you know, like the Maoists groups, Bandera Roja, which means red flag, you know, but because you had the Communist Party split in like three or four different parties. And you had Bandera Roja, and Bandera Roja split in Patria Roja, Red Fatherland, which still exists, and Sendero Luminoso, or Shining Path, you know, for example. All of the Maoists said that Velasco's government was like a fascist government. So they wanted to go against the reforms. Well, they tried to sabotage the government. But you also had the Communist Party of Peru, Unity, that also still exists. And nowadays they are allies with Patria Roja. But back in the day, they were really, really, I don't know, like peleados, Carlos, I don't know.
They were fighting against each other.
Yeah, they were rivals. So Unity did support, you know, they gave critical support to Velasco, you know, with other groups. You also had, for example, in the 60s, you had the National Liberation Army that tried to implement like a Guevarist guerrilla back here. And well, they didn't succeed, but they were an inspiration for Velasco, and their leader, who's still alive, he's called Hector Béjar. He did support Velasco's government. Well, it might be imprecise to say that it was absolutely top down, because you had like this long history of indigenous revolts here, of peasant revolts here. And Velasco just like accelerated the process. Yeah, he took the, I don't know how to say, la posta, Carlos?
That's not a Cuban Spanish word, right? That's my reference.
I don't know, he took the lead from the, you know, the peasants and peasant movements and indigenous movements. So it wasn't absolutely top down, yeah? And he even tried with Béjar, you know, this guy from the National Liberation Army. He founded, you know, the revolutionary government of the armed forces. They implemented a group that was called Sinamos. And it was like the unofficial party of the government. And they wanted to work directly with the masses. You know, they tried to build some sort of social democracy. I'm not meaning like social democracy, like the left-leaning social democracy. I mean like a democracy for the people, no? That was like that had like a dialectical relationship with the government, no? that sort of thing. They tried to implement that. That was all destroyed when the right-wing faction of the military took over in 75. They even destroyed all of the investigations that Sinamos was doing, because they had a lot of, it had a political wing, but also an intellectual wing, and they did a lot of research back in the day. They destroyed all of that, you know, the right wing in the military. So how did it change the Peruvian political and social landscape? I think that if you see it from that point of view, it was revolutionary. It was, because before Velasco, this country was what Marxists in the day called semi-feudal. You know, you had serfdom, right? In the Andean South and the North and almost all of the country, except the coast. Well, you had the haciendas and the landlords that we called back in the day gamonales. They were like, you know, like small kings, you know, like petty kings in almost all of the country, and they ruled in the name of the state. You know, the state actually almost all of the laws back in the day, they had to have permission from the gamonales to even apply them. So, yeah,
almost like feudal lords.
Yeah, almost a feudal order. So Velasco abolished that. And from that point of view, it was revolutionary. What we could call it like a democratic revolution, right? A political revolution. But it was incomplete. It was incomplete, it still is. For example, we didn't have a universal vote until 1980, because it was reserved for people that could read and write. So yeah, Velasco did like I'd say the Peru that we know right now, that made possible for someone like Castillo to get where he is, was made by Velasco. So he's very popular among the people here. And he's being vindicated more and more by the left. I'd say most of the left right now, except the Shining Path, they hate him.
That's fascinating. Thank you. Those are great.
But they hate him because, you know, when the Shining Path did their popular warfare back in the 80s, they had I don't know how to say it, an analysis from this country that they made before Velasco's reforms. No, they presupposed the semi-feudal conditions here in Peru. So they thought they would gain support from the peasants based on that analysis. And I've heard that they even had some people in the party that wanted to make a new research, but Guzman didn't want to, because he wanted to go to, you know, warfare. So the fact that the peasants already were the owners of their own land sabotaged Guzman's plans. So he hates Velasco because of that, because many people say that in the end, like, Velasco retroactively defeated the Shining Path. So yeah, because I don't know, if it wasn't the case, they might have had a lot of support, but they didn't.
That's so interesting. Thank you.
Yeah, and my question kind of piggybacks on that last idea about Shining Path. I wondered if you could talk a little bit about the history of socialist thought in Peru. It seems like the figure of José Carlos Mariategui and the so-called Chairman Gonzalo are sort of the yin and yang of Peruvian Marxism from my perspective. One is beloved by many and hated by a few, and the other is hated by many and loved by a few. So I was wondering what comments you had on the lasting legacy of those two figures on Peruvian politics, and also to what extent is it fair to call Free Peru today Maria Tegui's party?
Okay, that's a really good question too. Let's see. So Maria Tegui isn't a very interesting figure. I think he has, I don't know, maybe he's really similar to Gramsci, actually, Mariategui. And the interesting thing is that Mariategui became a Marxist in Italy because he was I don't know how to say it. Like he was expelled from the country back in the day because of his participation in popular mobilizations. And he went to live to Italy, and he was, as a journalist, he was side by side with the popular mobilizations in Italy, with the working class and peasants in Italy. And he was present when they founded the Communist Party of Italy. So, and well, he read a lot of Italian authors. He was very much influenced by the same sources of Gramsci, you know, besides Lenin and Marx and Engels, also Croce and those are like Italian Hegelians. They were very much present in Mariátegui's education. He was also very influenced by Sorel. You know, he has a thing for Sorel. He loves him. That's complicated for me, but he does. And wasn't
one of his early Peruvian mentors an anarchist who was in the government, an anarchist politician, right?
Oh, well, you mean González Prada, Manuel González Prada. Well, he was more like an bourgeois intellectual, you know, but he's sort of the godfather of the Peruvian left, González Prada, right? He has these vindications of the indigenous peoples back here. And he was one of the first intellectuals that asserted the need for the indigenous peoples to become a political agent of their own, for their own emancipation. So that's really important in González Prada, for and also for Mariátegui. Right. What Mariátegui, I'd say that he's also really interesting because he's in direct opposition to what was happening in Latin American socialism back in the day. That was, I don't know, the first Marxist intellectual in Latin America is from Argentina, and he was pretty much indebted with the Second International. I don't remember his name right now, but you know, like very rationalist and also positivistic in his perspectives, and like with an evolutionary way of comprehending Marxism, you know, like a theory of social formations and whatever. And Mariátegui, well, very, very much influenced by the Russian Revolution, was pretty much, how would I say it? He has like this romantic perspective. Yeah, pretty much like he understands Leninism as a sort of heroism and a revolutionary romanticism. He also says that. And he has this like, he also has similarities with Walter Benjamin. I don't know if you have read him. He has Benjamin has this thing with, you know, with Judaism and the Kabbalah and whatever, like the theological aspects of the revolution. So Mariátegui is similar in that respect to Benjamin. He's influenced by this like millenary mythical force in the Andean culture. You know, the indigenous peoples here in Peru have this, and also in Bolivia have this myth of the Incarri. I don't know if you ever heard of that. No, that this like prophecy, like messianic thing, that someday, you know, the chosen one of the Incas will come and you know, destroy colonialism, you know, and take the people.
Like Armageddon.
Yeah,
kind of,
yeah.
Almost. Yeah.
Not that much, but it is like they have us. It has become more and more secular. You know, like there is a Marxist interpretation of Incarri, you know, that in the end they will like appropriate the forces of modernity and use it against, you know? So yeah, it's like a syncretic thing of modernity, but also a recognition of this mythical force that can be used to mobilize political will. Yeah, so yeah, it's Mariátegui since he is very much displeased with the interpretations of the Second International that are pretty Eurocentric and rationalist, he put the emphasis in the, this mythical aspect, no, this heroism, and also the like passion. And he says that in the end, yeah, Marxism is a science, and as a science is a weapon and it's important, but what is really important for a revolutionary, it's his faith. His faith, his conviction, and his, he calls it like almost a religious sentiment. So yeah, he's pretty much intense and romantic and whatever. So, and also another important thing is, as I said, he's this thing he inherits from González Prada, that in Peru, like most of the working class is indigenous. So you have to interpret the conditions of Peru, not from the point of view of the European proletariat and industrialized proletariat, but from the point of view of the indigenous peoples. And the proletariat, like the small number of industrial proletariat in Peru, has to lead or be side by side with these indigenous peoples. So there's a need for a specifically Peruvian Andean indigenous Marxism. He's very insistent about that. He even has like this famous phrase that Peruvian Marxists use a lot. It's almost a cliche, like socialism hasn't, it's something like it has to be, Carlos, I need your help. He says something like, ni calco ni copia, creación heroica.
Socialism can't be a copy, it has to be a heroic creation.
Something like that. So yeah, that's what I can say about Mariátegui. But
so that idea of the sort of that idea of looking at the indigenous people and you know, having them at their perspective as the proletarian perspective in Peru. Gonzalo was inspired by that idea, contributed by Mariátegui, right?
Yeah.
How did Gonzalo differ from him, or did he?
You know, the name Shining Path is from a quote from Mariátegui. He called Marxism the shining path to revolution or something like that. So, they wanted to, take Mariátegui for themselves. No, they wanted to vindicate this figure that was, according to Gonzalo, was forgotten or wasn't properly remembered. So yeah, they considered themselves Mariátegui-ists. They were Maoists, and they were, Gonzalo in particular was very much impressed with the Cultural Revolution. He was there back in the day. He was trained in China in the times of the Cultural Revolution. I even say that that's the main thing he takes from Mao beside the popular warfare idea. But I'd say that in a way, if you see Mariátegui's texts and you read them literally, yeah, well, you may say they are Mariátegui's, but I think the main thing, this idea of innovation and interpretation based in the real conditions of our country, that's not that much in Gonzalez. I'd say that it isn't for a couple of reasons. First of all, Mariátegui died very young. He was almost 30 or a little over 30 when he died. So he didn't expand it a lot of his research on Peru. And he used many of, you know, like the concepts of the Third and the Second International for his interpretations, you know, like semi-feudal and, you know, the social formations scheme. So in Mariategui's case, I understand that because he died young and whatever, but Gonzalo had 30 years to expand over that and he didn't. So he had these interpretations of interpretation of our country as, you know, he thought he could understand it as almost European feudal system, and it had its differences, important differences. There's also the fact that Gonzalo had this, or I don't know, the Gonzalists at least, they had this pretty radical, or maybe radical is not the most adequate word, maybe I'd say extreme, it's different, right? So anti-capitalism, to the point that commerce in general was considered capitalist. So over the fact that peasants didn't want to follow them because they already had land, they also didn't want the peasants to, you know, go and commerce with other communities because that was capitalist. So they punished many peasants because of that, and that gained them, you know, opposition with the people. Also, I don't know, it's many things in that way. And yeah, he also thought that Peru was an almost copy of Mao's interpretation of China. So that was also pretty problematic. The fact that they preferred their own analysis from the, because it was my own lecture is that they prefer this analysis, even though they knew that there was a changing situation in the country, is because because in the end it was an opportunity to do the revolution. Yeah, it was like a voluntaristic thing, you know, because it's like they had the chance to do what the left talked about all day long, and they just jumped overboard to do it.
And it was a protracted people's war, so the first step is to take up the guns.
Yeah, and the thing is that back in the day when they did this warfare, you had a pretty interesting thing going on in Peru with the democratic left. You had this that almost all of the communist and socialist parties back in the day, except the Shining Path, had united in a front that was called the United Left. And they went into the elections and they were pretty strong because after Velasco's government, the working class was pretty, I don't know how would you say, like empowered. Like they were really, Velasco did a lot of reforms to benefit the unions and the working class, so they were pretty strong back in the day, and they were the ones that overthrew the right wing military government, and they were the ones that got the Constituent Assembly of 79. So the working class movement was pretty strong, and the peasant movement was pretty strong, and the United Left was like really promising. But then you got the Shining Path, and that, you know, like, was, how would I say, it weakened the image of the left in the eyes of the public.
So do you think that could relate to how things are today with, you know, Castillo sort of denouncing the left wing of his own party? In a way, and sort of the distance between, you know, the Free Peru and Castillo and the what's considered the far left, and as well as Venezuela and you know other left wing groups.
Oh, okay. Well, first of all, Castillo is not from Free Peru. He was invited by the party. And well, Free Peru, as you said, Mitchell, is, or at least it says it is, a Marxist-Leninist, Mariategist party. I'll answer the other question that you made before that. I think it is, in a way, you have like the vanguard in the party, no? Like a few interesting political cadres are Marxist-Leninists. They are the founder, the general secretary, no, Serrón. He's also a Marxist. He was educated in Cuba, and his father was also a Marxist. And I think they are like they have this political formation, but the party is growing. And it's a young party, and it's not that organized. I mean, at the beginning they were, and in the first part of these elections, that organization served well Castillo. But right now it's growing rapidly, and they don't have this, the new cadres don't have this formation. So I'd say it's mixed. It's mixed, and it needs urgently this kind of political formation. Also, well, I was saying that Castillo is not an official member of the party, or he wasn't before these elections. He joined in December or something. Castillo is a union leader, right? A union leader from this, like teachers union from the Andes. And I'd say Castillo has more of a left-wing nationalism thing. He's not a Marxist. I think I'm speculating here, but I think he's familiarized with Marxism. He must know, because most of the teachers are familiar with Marxism and Leninism here. But Castillo's also a Christian. He's evangelical. So I don't know. That's like an hypothesis of mine. I'm not sure, but I think that may preclude him from going full blown into Marxism. I don't know. But he's an ally, and I think he's more like an Evo Morales profile leader. And that's good. We need that. We need to develop this, or to finish this democratic revolution that was started back in 68. We need that. And Castillo, in that sense, is important, really important as a leader. He has congregated a vast popular movement that we hadn't seen since at least the 80s. But also, there are tensions with, I wouldn't say there are tensions with the left in the party. I'd say that the thing is that Serrón, the secretary of the party, he was sentenced like last year. He has a sentence like most regional left-wing leaders back here. He has a sentence. So the press used this to try and put Peru Libre, Free Peru, as almost as corrupt as Fujimori. They tried to play this card that, we know that Keiko has these issues nexus with, I don't know how you say it, like, narco traffic and whatever, but you have Serrón, and Serrón is sentenced, so he's just as bad, as Keiko and whatever. So they got to compromise Castillo and Serrón, that Serrón would, he would deal directly with party issues, and Castillo would deal directly with the campaign. So the press, they tried a lot to show Castillo as Serrón's puppet, and they tried to infantilize him, since he has an accent from the North Andes, and in Lima they are the worst. So they try to put him as a childlike figure and an ignorant and whatever, and that he was surely manipulated by Serrón. And he needed to distance from Serrón, and that was as I said, they had a compromise, that he had like Ceron's blessing to do that. But at times it was evident that the right and the press and also some segments of the left outside Peru Libre, like more moderate liberal segments of the left, they all tried to like weaken this alliance between Cerrón and Peru Libre and Castillo. Well, they wanted to break the alliance so they could co-opt Castillo. So it's like a delicate balance they were, no? And also you also have the fact that, yeah, they are Marxist-Leninist in the like the political cadres of the party, but since the Shining Path and everything, communism is like evil here. You know, like the McCarthyism is really, really strong in Peru. So when Castillo was in his campaign, the press tried to put communism as something that had to do almost exclusively with expropriations to small, you know, to small peasants and enterprises, small enterprises, and violent death. So in his campaign, Castillo was like, well, if that means to be a communist, then they are the communists. Yeah. And many people in Argentina and Chile and whatever from communist parties were like, so Castillo is also a McCarthyist and he hates communists. But I think it's much more complex than that. Yeah. Now the Venezuela thing, I don't think, I mean, for me, anti-imperialism is like, it has utmost importance. For me, you can't be in Latin America, in the third world in general, a Marxist without being anti-imperialistic and anti-colonial, right? So for example, the other left-wing coalition in these elections, Juntos por el Perú, with Veronica Mendoza, yeah, well, they were at least in front of cameras, they did denounce Venezuela, no? Because they are all day long with the microphone and telling you, well, so do you think Venezuela is a dictatorship or not? And they're like that all day long. So in the end, Juntos por el Perú did assume that narrative, that yeah, well, they are a dictatorship, no? So we won't interfere in their affairs, but we think that they are a dictatorship. But Peru Libre never did that until now. They haven't done that. I think they have like one cadre that right now is the vice president. She's postulating for the vice presidency. And I think she said once in the press that, but Castillo has never said that. And Cerrón is openly pro Venezuela. And they also use that against Castillo, you know, the fact that Cerrón has these like pictures in Caracas, you know, and with Maduro and whatever. But I appreciate the fact that Castillo hasn't got to say anything of that sort. And in the first part of the elections, he also did say openly that he considered that it was a democracy. So I don't know, in the end, it doesn't mean anything because it's an instrument to win the election or whatever, but I do appreciate the fact that he didn't compromise his principles. So, yeah.
Well, you touched on a point there that it works as a nice segue for the next question, which is what happened in that epoch right before the electoral run of Pedro Castillo. And one of the things you mentioned that I'm sure most folks didn't know was that Pedro wasn't necessarily in the party. He was asked to run. So I wanted to ask you, can you paint us a picture of how the teacher strike Castillo led in 2018 came about? What role did that movement play for the transition into the electoral realm? And then additionally, can you tie this development to the class makeup of the party, to its differentiation with the other major party on the left, which you mentioned, Juntos por Peru, and how these differentiations unfolded during the electoral struggle?
Okay, that's a hard one. The protest that you're talking about was in 2017, 2017. Yeah, well, that's actually pretty important for these elections right now. And so Castillo was part of this teachers union, and almost all of the teachers unions in Peru are subordinated to what we call the SUTEP, no? That is like the general union of teachers in Peru. So the SUTEP's leadership is from one of our communist parties, the Patria Roja. I mentioned it before. Patria Roja, or Red Fatherland, they were Maoists back in the 70s and the 80s. Right now, they don't use the Maoist thing anymore. They are Marxist, Leninist, Mariateist too. And they have a lot of like contacts in China. They are pretty much in that line, you know, and it's pretty interesting. But they also have they lead the SUTEP, and they have control of the what we call the derrama magisterial. It's like the private how do you say it, like seguros,
insurances.
Yeah, like the insurances for the teachers. They administrate the insurances. So many times they don't want to clash with the government, Patria Roja. They are like more, I would say, diplomatic. So they had this like confrontation with their bases in the unions. No, that the teachers wanted to go to strike and Patria Roja didn't want to. So they split it. And Castillo was designated as the teachers' leader. So yeah, well, you have like a pretty hard antagonism between Red Fatherland and the teachers. Many cadres of Patria Roja went even to TV with Kuczynski, who was a president back in the day, and they denounced the teachers as members of the Shining Path and terrorists or whatever. So yeah, it was a pretty tough breakup. And but in the end, the teachers prevailed. The protest was massive, and they have massive popular support. I was there back in the day with the organization I militated back at the time, and many student movements and a lot of left-wing organizations were backing them up. So they won most of the things they were asking for, among them salary and pensions and whatever. But they didn't get everything they wanted. You know, they had to negotiate, and you know, as usual. So the teachers decided to make their own party. They wanted to, you know, to make a new left-wing party with Castillo as their leader. But they didn't have time to constitute this organization and go to the elections. So there you have Peru Libre and Cerrón. Cerrón and Veronica Mendoza, the leader of Juntos por el Perú, they tried to form their own coalition, but they didn't succeed. I will talk about this in a few moments. But so Cerrón was alone, and he had his party, and he couldn't postulate because he was sentenced. Oh, he had a habeas corpus the other day, so he's free right now, by the way. So he had this sentence and he couldn't go in as a presidential candidate. So he had these talks with Castillo last year, and they got him into the project. And that's the alliance between the union, no, the teachers union of Castillo, and the Ronderos, no, who are the, I don't know if you've read about the Ronderos or heard about them. The Ronderos are like a militia, like a self-defense militia from the many peasant communities and indigenous communities in here in Peru. They were formed to fight against the Shining Path back in the day, you know, to protect their own communities. And also from protect them from the army, as you know, because they were. You know. So Castillo, when he was a teenager, he was a rondero. So when he was like 40 or 14 or 15, so he had the back, he had the ronderos with him. So with the teachers and the ronderos, you know, as a like a broad, you know, social movement, they allied with Free Peru and did what they've been doing, you know, like. The other part of the question was about Juntos por el Peru, right?
Yeah, well, how did this transition into the political affect the class makeup of both Peru Libre and Juntos por Peru?
Okay, so Peru Libre is a regional party. It's from what we call the North Highlands. You know, Peru is divided into coasts, no, coastline, no, Pacific, and the highlands, the Andes, no, and what we call the jungle. No, it's like the next, no, to the Amazon in the Brazilian limits. So Junin is in the North Andean part of the country, next to the jungle. And Cerrón was the regional governor of Junin. And the party was formed in that region. So Peru Libre's makeup is, I'd say, popular, almost entirely popular. Peasants, working class, and maybe a few petit bourgeois, no, members, but regional petit bourgeois, which is very important here in Peru, because you have you are not from Lima, that's an important thing here. So on the other side, you had Juntos por el Peru. Juntos por el Peru is not a party, it's a coalition between Veronica Mendoza's party, which is Nuevo Peru, New Peru. And New Peru is pretty much eclectic. You have like democratic socialism, and you have classic social democratic cadres, and you have a few Leninists, and you have even Trotskyites. I don't know how you say it, but it's pretty much eclectic. And in the coalition, you also have Red Fatherland, like the Communist Party Red Fatherland, and the Peruvian Communist Party Unity. Also, a couple of other parties, I don't remember right now. One of them is called the Humanist Party, I think, which were the ones who had the signature they needed, the inscription they needed to postulate for the elections, you know, this Humanist Party. But they had a fight in the middle of the elections, and they went to Peru Libre, this Humanist Party. But I don't know. This Juntos por el Peru is more, I'd say, westernized in a lot of ways. They are not entirely from Lima, but I'd say they are like culturally and they're like the central, you know, thing, like the committee or whatever, they are from Lima, almost all of them. Yeah. I don't know, Mendoza is from Cusco, but she's, you know, she's white and she studied in the Sorbonne and whatever, right? So yeah, it's pretty much westernized in many ways. And they have they do have a pretty radical basis, but most of them are middle class.
So speaking of westernized middle class, petite bourgeoisie, That brings us to the Organization of American States, of course. So that's my question. Do you think the election is over, or is this going to continue? As you know, the OAS tends to play a crucial role in stopping leftist governments from being elected and in staying in power. This week's OAS observation mission statement seems to give this election an international stamp of approval, but it leaves the door open, saying, among other things, the OAS, this is a quote from their statement, the OAS electoral observation mission will continue to monitor the process until its conclusion and will present a preliminary report in the coming days. So my question is, what's the OAS up to?
I don't know. Nothing good, I think.
I think we can assume that.
Well, let's say I wanted to say a few things about the ideological thing differences between Peru Libre and Juntos por Peru, but I talk about that later. I don't know about the OAS. I think they are here to be beside Keiko if she, I don't know, if she in the end gets with her way, you know, if she finds a way to overrule the election or whatever, the OAS will be here to confirm the fraud, you know, or whatever she says to annul the elections. So I think that's the role that they are playing here. You know? I don't know.
They just haven't come up with anything good yet.
No, they haven't. And also Evo, I don't know if you read that Evo was like tweeting about the OAS in Peru, and Castillo was thanking him for the advice or whatever. So yeah, it's obvious, right? Nobody's pretending.
So do you think they're confused at this result, that it's too close and that they don't really know what to do?
I mean, Keiko Fujimori, I don't know if you know, but she has like, after the elections, she has a case open, and she's right. Like facing almost 31 years for—
Right. Yeah, so the desperation is in the air,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, and yeah, yeah. So I don't know, she'll try almost everything. I think right now that it's probable that she'll try to apply for asylum, maybe in Brazil or whatever. But that the other thing she's doing is that she's like giving the most reactionary members of the bourgeoisie and the middle classes a narrative to cling, no, to. But because even if Castillo has already won, but even if he takes the presidency, there you have like a pretty big part of the country that doesn't consider him legitimate because of what they've done. So yeah, it would be pretty rough. And I don't think she has a chance to annul the elections. I don't think that she won't, that she will, but in the end, the OAS, I think, it's here just for, if there is a chance, they will be here. I think that's it. It's not more than that.
They'll grab any piece of any bit of evidence they can find and then stretch it out.
Yeah, you know, to see it, like, not to put the seeds of confusion or whatever, and to like make this, you know, this whole election seem foggy and illegitimate, yeah, or at least to put the shadow of the doubt in the minds of the people. So yeah.
Thanks. Kayla, go for it.
Yeah, let me hop in. So I have two questions. I was actually really enjoying your discussion of Mendoza and how the party differs in that way. If you wanted to expand on that, I'd like to do that first before I ask my wrap question. Is that all right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thanks. So I think one of the problems that the first part of the elections, I don't know if you have heard of this, but when the first statistics of the elections were public, Castillo wasn't even there. or he was like in the margins, he was like, you know, I followed Castillo's campaign from the beginning, almost the beginning, like from January or whatever. And he wasn't in the statistics, but when you saw the videos of what was happening in the regions, you know, they were like massive congregations. And it was amazing because almost all of the sociological tools they were using, you know, even in the left, because almost all of, you know, like the Limian official left, no, they were enamored with Mendoza, no? They were all Mendoza, they were all supporting Mendoza, and they all of their cards were with Mendoza. And Castillo was invisible. And even when, I don't know, almost all of the attacks of the media were against Mendoza, because the establishment, even until the last week before the elections, hadn't figured that Castillo was first. He was invisible. So, and that was symptomatic because it was not just the right wing who were fooled. It was also the left, or some part of the left. About the ideological thing, I got into a lot of fights with some of my friends from, you know, the academic left. Because I think there's like a common sense about the left that has taken root in Lima a lot. That like a political force, a political organization, it's like, how would I say it? Like a shopping list, you know, that you have to have all of the right causes inside, so you can support them with a good conscience. And Juntos por el Perú is like that, because it's pretty much westernized, at least their leadership is pretty much westernized. So they have the LGBTQ movement, and they also have I don't know, at least from the mouth outside, you have indigenous causes and colonization causes and working class and everything, or everything's there, yeah. But on the,
with an exception,
there's an exception. They are not anti-imperialist. They are not anti-imperialist. Not at least in public. Maybe in private, the Patriarch Red Fatherland and the other Communist Party, maybe in private, they are anti-imperialists. When you talk to them, they are, but not for the media, okay? So they even, there was also like, how do you say, Carlos, how do you say, scandalo?
Well, in English, it's scandalous. There was a scandal.
There was some scandalous thing going on, because they have like, you know, that the right and the press, they had this, they had this conversation from one of the leaders of Juntos por el Perú, one of the congresswomen who was presenting for the party. And in this conversation, she says openly that they are going for the middle classes, that they don't give a shit, that it was pretty much scandalous. So they didn't give a shit about, you know, like popular classes, and because their vote didn't count, and they had to assure the support of the middle classes, because, you know, like half of the population is in Lima, it's like 50% of the country is congregated in Lima. So they needed their support. That was their strategy, which to me was like counterintuitive, because the lessons I got for the election of 2016, where I supported Mendoza, was that they needed to work with the people in the regions, and they needed, you know, like to how do you say, like besiege Lima, something like that, from the regions. And that's what Peru Libre went for. You know, like they worked with the regions, and they had the ronderos, and they had the teachers, and they had almost close to zero coverage in the media, but they were in the regions making their campaign side by side with the people and congregating thousands of persons in the plazas. But many people from Juntos por el Perú and the more like academic or middle class left didn't want to support Peru Libre, and they even thought that it could be pernicious for Mendoza, and they were pretty incensed about it. And they didn't like the party. And if you read the discussion with Crisancho, you might have seen what it had to do with the fact that, they are conservative and they are not with this more, I don't know, they don't have a formation in gender studies, and they don't have, they don't have this more cosmopolitan perspective. And it's true, they don't. Not all of them. I think it's that's like a generalization, but it was not like their main thing. You know, they were more with, their discourse went more with the peasant movements and with the rights of the indigenous people and with the working class discourse. And I'd say this because many people in Lima thought they were not feminists, that they didn't care about the women's cause or the gender problem. And I think that was wrong. It's just that they didn't use the word feminist. They didn't use it, but in the regions in Peru, you have a lot of women organizations, from peasant women and working class women and ronderas and all of that. And of course they have a different perspective from feminists from Lima, which is more similar to feminists in Buenos Aires or whatever, but it's part of the women's cause, right? So my point is that, it was like incomplete, they didn't have all of the rave indications as part of their program, but it seemed clear to me that they were going the right way because they were building this progressive political force from the popular masses. And it's a process, right? And even if it had its issues, it was better to be wrong with the people, I think, than to have this like enlightened perspective from the upside, right? Which is like pretty common here, that even the left has this more like this tutelage thing, right? Which has been the problem with the Limian left for almost all of our history, even since Mariategui's time. Mariategui has discussions about this, right? The difference between the regional left and the Limian left. So right now Castillo is making like alliances. He has an alliance with Juntos por el Perú. One of the issues with Peru Libre is that they didn't have much technical cadres. And Juntos por el Perú have given them the cadres, right? And he's making alliances. He has he has meets with people from LGBT organizations, and he's now meeting with feminists. And I think that was the thing they had to do. They had to support them. They have to approach them. They have to have a dialogue. And in the end, they would all recognize as a progressive force, and they will implement these causes. Because I think the great thing about Castillo in particular as a leader is that he knows how to negotiate as a union leader. You know, that's his thing. And he has showed a pretty democratic spirit, you know, in the good sense. You know, he's even if he is more of a social, he has a conservative perspective for these sexual morality things. He's open to discussion. And he also, I've seen in discussions I've had with many leftist people from around the world, especially from the West, that they have the same issues with the fact that he said in an interview, for example, that he's against like same-sex marriage or whatever. And the press and even some parts of Juntos por el Perú in the first part of the election used that against him. They were like, no, he's the same thing as a right-wing conservative or whatever. And I think it's pretty different, because in the right you have a explicitly anti, you know, anti-gay or anti-feminist thing, and Castillo hadn't. It was more like an omission, which is not the same. It's not the same thing. And he even said in those interviews that a lot of people are quoting that even if he personally had those positions because of his background, which by the way are positions that are shared by many people in his region, even if that was the case, it was not in his hands, right? It was something that would be decided when we join for the new constitution. And it depended upon the Peruvian people. So, and that was like, that's something they are not saying, right? That he also said that, which I think is pretty important too. So anyways, that's the thing.
Well, I think that leads me to my next question. I think you're absolutely right on that the most important leftist is the one that can get elected, right? And it sounds like he had that sort of volition. So that brings me to the constitution question, which I think is the one that's on everyone's mind. What is the current thinking about how we actually get there? We have this sort of, from my understanding, the constitution that's currently in use is the one that was from the previous Fujimori mm-hmm. Administration. And so it's sort of this hangover of this neoliberal document that is missing a lot of things. So I know he has a number of proposals that are very exciting, but he also has a pretty hostile Congress and a steep vote count if he's going to get there sort of the traditional way. So are there indications of where they're going? If they can't get the vote, what do we do? What does the future look like? Those sorts of questions. And this is obviously presuming that the election will stand and that there will not be interference. And I'm just saying that that's happening because I'm willing it.
Well, the traditional way to do the new constitution to replace this one, because this one was, as you said, it was elaborated during the first Fujimori's father back in the day, mm-hmm. in 1993. Yeah. And it was, and this is important, it was dictatorially imposed, right? Because yeah. he closed Congress and she just, and there was some, everybody knows that there was a fraud, no, and whatever. The traditional way to make the new constitution is with the approval of the Congress. But it's not the only route. We have other options. And I think the one that Peru Libre has chosen is the referendum. You know, the referendum is part of this, like what I think the lawyers call constituent process. No, this is like a constituent process. So they would go for the referendum. And I don't know, most of the population has manifested in favor of changing the constitution. So I think I think they could actually do it unless it's sabotaged in some way, you know, that I'm missing from the, you know, from the right. But I don't know. I don't know. They have a lot of, they have been talking with a lot of people from Ecuador and Bolivia and Chile, you know, to try and learn from their own processes. So I think there's a chance, and the new constitution is like the main proposition from Peru Libre, no? Because it would be, I don't know if you have that. I don't know how it is outside of Latin America, but you have like two options, right? That the constituent assembly with the people from the Congress, no, from the political parties, or you have the chance to do it with people elected specifically for the assembly, no, like the popular constituent assembly. That's how we call it here. And they are opting for that, you know, with a quota of representation from indigenous peoples and paritary, is it called like that? Like 50% women, 50% men. Yeah, well, so we're going for that, and as part of the referendum. So I don't know. I don't know, and it all depends, because it is true that right now the political climate is pretty like divided. Divided. You have this right wing that has become more and more fascistic in the last months, and anti-communism and McCarthyism right now is pretty strong. And I don't know, there's even a chance that if they find a way to annul the elections, I don't think they will, but if they do, that would end up in some sort of violent confrontation. It's almost clear to me it will be that way. So, and if that's the case, you have a perfect excuse for the military to come out, right? So, I don't know, we'll see.
That makes perfect sense. I think that that aligns with basically what I'd understood. I hadn't understood that the referendum offered two options, or that it had the chance to call a popular constituency. That's really interesting. I will look more into that. That sounds promising, but yeah, we'll have to pray there's no interference. And should I wrap up, or does anyone have any other questions, or how are we feeling?
Well, is there anything else you want to mention, Sebastian, before we go? Anything you felt like we left off the table? Maybe something in relation to it? Are there any plans to reacting to what is potentially going to be new blockades and all of that coming from the U.S.? Because that's pretty much a given. We know that a priori.
I don't think there will be a blockage. I don't know. Because we don't have, you know, like the strategically important place that Venezuela has, for example, right? We are not in the same position. So I'm right now, I'm not that afraid about it. Okay. Because you know, the program for the next 5 years, it's not that radical. They can do much in 5 years. And you know that the three main things are like the new constitution and the renegotiation of some contracts, you know, like for gasification and whatever, and also the I don't know, they have implemented a few things from Juntos por el Perú's plan about making a tax for the rich or whatever, but it's like 1% or 2, it's pretty low. So I don't see, you know, anything like that will come. I think the main thing about the Castillo's government is the democratic aspect of it. Or the fact that it is the first peasant president that we have. Even Velasco was like a criollo, a creole. He was from the north of the coast. He's beloved by the people or whatever, but he's not one of the people. Castillo is. And you know, it goes with this plurinational project, almost in line with the one you have in Bolivia, because right here in Peru you have things that all of the services from the state are in Spanish, for example, and that's pretty shady for most of the population outside of the coast, because you have a lot of people that don't have Spanish as a first language. And so, yeah, there's this sociologist, Marxist sociologist, René Zavaleta, I don't know if you know him, from Bolivia. Zavaleta has this concept that I like, that García Linera uses a lot, the apparent state. You know, that it is the fact that from a Marxist perspective, you know, in Marx's texts, you have this thing that the state presents itself as the universal interest, but it fulfills the interests of a particular class. And that's like the model of Western democracy. But in South America, in countries like Bolivia and Peru, you don't have that. You know, like you hadn't that in South Africa either. You know? So, and I don't know, maybe even in the US at some point, you know, with the segregation or whatever. You have a state that doesn't presume to represent everyone. It openly rejects a section of the population that it's almost like a natural resource instead of people. So that's the thing that Velasco began to, you know, to change back in the day, but it hasn't changed in all the aspects of the thing. So I think the main thing that could come from Castillo's government is this cultural change. You know, the fact that people that are not from Lima or not from the coast can see eye to eye with the other citizens as equals. And that for me is a lot, you know, even if it's not a socialist revolution. So a democratic revolution will be fine for now, I think, and I don't think that will get us a blockage. I hope so, at least.
Well, we will sustain that hope with you, and we also hope that the decision stays and that it's not annulled and that there's no escalation in the near future. So we want to thank you very greatly for being here with us. It has been a very informative podcast. I know I learned a whole lot. Yeah, if you don't have anything else that you would like the audience to know, we can probably sign out. All righty.
Well, thank you.
Thank you, Sebastian.
No, thank you all for the invitation. Yeah, I was pretty honored.
That's great.
All righty. This is the Midwestern Marx podcast signing out.